fun and games until someone loses an eye. And in the case of thermonuclear war, that would be 15 billion eyes. That's right, today I want to talk about nuclear war because the Doomsday Clock announcement just came out and it is terrible news.
Today, the Bulletin of the Atomic Scientists moves the hands of the Doomsday Clock. It is 100 seconds to midnight.
This is the closest to midnight the clock has ever been in the history of ever, and I'm absolutely terrified. So what does this mean for us, and is there anything we can do about it? So 2020's begun, and it's off to a terrible start. But despite all this, I'm still kind of surprised that this looming topic of nuclear war isn't dominating our headlines more. It's certainly dominating my head. And maybe this is because it's hard to visualize, but it's truly one of the most horrific things I can think of, killing you and me and everyone we hold dear, and any survivors probably wishing they'd died along with us. And now this new Doomsday Clock announcement's come out, suggesting we may be at the sketchiest point we've ever seen in human history. The main reason being these renewed tensions between major nuclear powers, to the point we may even be on the brink of a brand new arms race. I mean, it's literally insane how many times we've been on the brink of war because of some bizarre reason or another. Just look at the length of this list of close calls. Each one a critical moment in our history where we all nearly went up in smoke. And I mean, a quick search found 11 of them, and these are only the ones that have been made public. In fact, it almost feels like the only reason we are still here is because we're on some kind of lucky timeline of the multiverse, because my God, some of these close calls are stupid. Like in 1960, when radar equipment in Greenland mistook moonrise over Norway for Soviet missiles, and the only reason the US didn't immediately launch was because the head of the USSR happened to be in NYC at the time, and they figured it'd be a bit weird for him to attack himself. Or how about a year later, when the entire US nuclear air force was put on standby because two communications lines, which were designed to be completely independent of each other, went down at the same time because of a single relay station failing in Colorado. Or 6 years after that, when they nearly launched because a freaking solar flare jammed NORAD radars and they got all suspicious. Or in 1979, when a training software was mistakenly loaded onto a computer and the president was given a 7-minute window to decide whether or not to launch a counterattack. And of course, the famous 1983 incident where we'd all be toast were it not for Stanislav Petrov. Petrov was a Soviet radar officer who bravely ignored strict military protocol and went with his gut that it was a false alarm, an action that probably saved more lives than anyone else has done in history. And seriously, how that guy didn't get a Nobel Peace Prize is beyond me. Estimates suggest he saved around 250 million people from the initial war, and up to 2 billion further would have died from starvation in nuclear winter. And yet, when you Google the name Petrov, he doesn't even appear in the first page of Google. What is wrong with us? I mean, just imagine the perspective from aliens out there who are, say, watching the Earth show in its current season. You know, they must have really reached for the popcorn when we started building nukes, but God, imagine what they must be thinking. How dumb we must look, considering we're still on hair trigger alert multiple episodes later after all these close calls. I mean, they must be thinking the show's just jumped the shark and the writers have gotten lazy and are just milking the same scenario over and over. Which makes me wonder, just how lucky have we been? You know, were all these close calls as close as they actually felt? And is there a way we can estimate the chances of nuclear war per year? Well, yes, you can, but it's hard to do accurately. One way would be to go from year one of the Cold War and assume a uniform probability distribution, because of course we have no idea back then what the chances of nuclear war would be at all. And then we would do a Bayesian update, where each year of peace would act as evidence against the likelihood of war. And this method results in a risk ranging between 0.1 and 1% per year, which, if it doesn't sound like much to you, remember that probabilities compound. I mean, if planes had a 1 in 100 chance of crashing, I doubt you'd be okay with yourself and everyone you know keep getting on them and flying time after time. Now, some people say we're all worrying over nothing because we've made it through the last 70 years of nuclear threat, so it can't be that dangerous. But as I said in my last video on anthropic bias, there are certain thinking errors that can arise, especially this one called survivor bias. Because honestly, it's pretty damn annoying from a risk assessment standpoint that only the survivors of an existential threat are around to be able to then estimate the likelihood of said existential threats. And that's because all the unlucky ones can't look back at the past to assess the risks because, well, they're already dead. And this survivor bias means we're almost certainly getting a rosier than average perspective of history because we are by necessity in one of the luckier timelines to be able to even have this conversation in the first place.
Now we can just slip into the place of our dead selves in this reality and everything will be fine.
Rick, what about the reality we left behind?
What about the reality where Hitler cured cancer, Morty? The answer is don't think about it.
So what can we do about this problem?
Why can't we all just get along?
But seeing as that's not happening anytime soon, we're kind of stuck in this complex coordination problem that's governed by extremely powerful game theoretic forces. It's like we're playing a dark game of international poker, where Earth is the wobbly table standing on a fragile leg, and we are just dust specks stuck to it with nowhere else to go. Fortunately, the game has been at a stalemate with everyone just folding their cards for decades, which has kept the table in balance. But occasionally, one player upgrades their stack, and this forces everyone else to upgrade theirs in response to maintain the table's balance. However, the more chips or players are added to the table, the more likely it'll break. So when other countries attempt to join, the players wisely try to stop them. Now obviously, no one wants the table to break, and so the players have two options. One, they can keep the stalemate going and just hope that no one makes any stupid bets with their increasingly heavy stacks. Or two, the players can agree to new rules of the game, where they slowly and carefully take chips off the table at the same time. In other words, treaties. Treaties like the 1968 Non-Proliferation and the 1988 INF have successfully produced loads of disarmament in the past. And so obviously option two is by far the best thing for everyone in the long run, because option one not only costs trillions of dollars to keep maintaining, money that could be better spent elsewhere, but it will almost certainly end in catastrophe. So given all this, there's still a few things even us dust specks can do to make the game less dangerous. And the most obvious one is to make sure we pick leaders who not only understand the short-term game dynamics, but are also able to step back and see the bigger picture and actually stick to existing treaties. Another easy thing we can all do is make sure our money isn't financing new nukes. And check out this website that lists companies and banks that like to help produce them. Also, there's a ton of further research that needs to be done, and organisations like the Future of Life Institute and the Bulletin of Atomic Scientists need support to hire game theorists and other scientists to build more accurate models of potential conflicts and their impacts. Their models help policymakers make smarter decisions, such as adding some checks and balances to the hair trigger alert system, or generally moving away from first strike to a deterrence-only strategy. But in the long run, we need to find a way to make these nuclear powers see each other more as teammates instead of opponents. To the point where the idea of a war between US and China or Russia is as absurd as a war between Pennsylvania and Maryland. Because we can't be consumed by our petty differences anymore. We must be united with our common interests. And perhaps it's fate that today is the 4th of July, and we are once again fighting for our freedom. But not from tyranny or oppression or persecution, but from annihilation. We're fighting for our right to live, to exist. Because we will not go quietly into that night. We will not vanish without a fight. We're going to live on. We're going to survive. Today, we celebrate our Independence Day. Thanks for watching, folks. If you enjoyed this, then smash that like button and subscribe because it helps others find the video. And do check out the links below, particularly the Future of Life Institute and the Bulletin of Atomic Scientists. Their research helped me write this. And also thanks to the Explosive Science folks for providing that amazing shot of the big boom of cloud. I can't speak anymore, too much Independence Day. But yeah, check out their YouTube and I'll see you guys next time.